Today, a number of people squeezed into a passage in Newgrange in the hope of witnessing that once-in-a-year event when light shines through into the inner chamber. It is an amazing piece of 5,000-year-old architecture. Anthony Murphy is the author of Newgrange, Monument to Immortality. Anthony, good afternoon to you.
Good afternoon.
The people who built Newgrange, what do we know about them?
Very little, Sean. It's very hard to piece together a picture of a people who lived and died 5,000 years ago. Mm. All we have is the monument, the stones, the carvings, and, you know, whatever tools and implements that have been found over the years. However, we have quite a substantial body of mythology, which, in my opinion, supports an interpretation of the function of Newgrange. It's actually quite a complex astronomical monument, probably more so than is currently accepted. It was a very disappointing dawn from the point of view that it was cloudy.
Yes, yes.
However, the biggest crowd I've ever seen at Newgrange gathered this morning, I think there was about 500. It was fantastic. It was a great atmosphere, whether the sun shines or not.
And do they still do the thing where they draw lots to see who actually gets inside?
The lottery. I'm not sure how many entered this year, but last year it was 31,500 for 50 places.
Yeah.
So, you know, you can enter as many times as you like.
Yes,
a lot of people
like
don't
know the other lotto that way. But I must say it's on my bucket list. But, you know, you'd hate to get there and then it's cloudy then, which would be kind of unfortunate. There's only kind of bits and pieces, but would it be safe to infer that because of the size of this monument, that community who built it must have been fairly prosperous?
Yeah, and peaceful.
Yeah.
They were unified in a way that I don't think there was slavery involved. I think this is, you know, there are three large monuments in the Boyne Valley and a smattering of smaller ones. And an incredible amount of labour went into their construction. In actual fact, it really was a regional project because a lot of the stone came from places as far away as the Cooley Peninsula. Wicklow is where the white quartz came from.
Mm.
It was a construction project of sorts because all of that material needed to be brought in a time when there were no roadways. The sea and the river were the main methods of transportation. There are about 200 large grey wacky slabs at Newgrange that were brought from Clare Head, which by sea and river is a distance of about 30 kilometres, maybe 40 kilometres. This is a community that wanted to express themselves very monumentally for some reason.
Mm.
And funny enough, when they finished, and this is one of the things I say in the book, when they finished building Newgrange, they stopped building spectacularly big monuments. Newgrange was the pinnacle.
Why isn't there another one? Or even a slightly smaller one?
Yeah. And it's a theme that I examine in the book with, you know, discussion with archaeologists as well. And they're not entirely sure either. They don't think there was a catastrophe. They don't think there was a large-scale population reduction.
Mm.
But something did happen when they were at the peak of their achievements. It may have been a sort of a shift from, you know, inclusive monuments exclusive monuments where only a certain few got into the chamber, and like the rest of us, we stood outside this morning. And that must have been what it was like when it was built. And after Newgrange, what you get are these large henges. Archaeologists call them embanked enclosures. And there's a very large example in the Boyne Valley. It's like a squashed egg-shaped embankment where you can imagine that, you know, maybe hundreds or even thousands of people could have gathered and enjoyed a sort of open-air ceremony. So that's one of the ideas that archaeologists have, is that in actual fact what happened was Newgrange was too exclusive. There's only room for about 15 people in there. So if 300 or 400 people turn up, you know, the majority have to stay outside.
It is a burial chamber. Does it have some other function?
Well, yeah, but archaeologists call it a passage tomb. That's the label they give it. But even archaeologists recognise that falls short of describing what Newgrange is about. It's not really a burial place because you couldn't bring a corpse in there, for instance. It's too impractical. Likely what happened was that the deceased were allowed to, let's say, rot in the open air. And it's been suggested in the UK that they built wooden platforms, I think at Stonehenge, where they allowed the corpse, and they brought just select bone fragments into the chamber. Some of them were burnt and some unburnt. And this is another, I suppose, mysterious aspect of Newgrange. But I think it's much more than that. It's a complex astronomical observatory for a start. That is likely to be wrapped up in whatever spirituality they had. I think Newgrange is an it's like a giant crossover between scientific study on one hand and then spiritual endeavour on the other, where the two seem to meet, because they studied the movements of the sun and the moon and the planets and the stars. They actually had quite a complex astronomy. I've argued that point, not only in my new book, but my previous one, Island of the Setting Sun. But the spiritual aspect of it is very interesting. The mythology of Newgrange speaks about the Tuatha Dé Danann, who are the ancient gods of Ireland, and they owned the monuments. And when the Milesians came from Spain, the Milesians came to Ireland to take it from the Tuatha Dé Danann. And this, I love this idea of the invasion mythology. It's one of the principal myths of ancient Ireland, is the Book of Takings, it's called, Leabhar Gabála. And there was a successive wave of invasions, and the Milesians came and took the country from the Tuatha Dé Danann. Now, there were some skirmishes, but the Tuatha Dé Danann, basically, who were immortal, by the way, and the Milesians were the sons of the King of Spain. The Tuatha Dé Danann basically just said, tell you what, here you go, here's the keys to the country, you can have it, and we'll just go on into the monuments here and let you run things. And to me, this is a stark reflection of that happening in modern day Ireland. It's, it's incredible how mythology seems to repeat itself over time. But specifically, the folklore about Newgrange and other monuments suggests that the Tuatha Dé Danann, the gods, used Newgrange as a portal between this world and the next world, and that they can migrate between this world and the next world using the monuments. To me, that's suggestive of, you know, this liminal aspect of Newgrange, that perhaps it helps you get to the other side, as it were.
And could, I mean, the very deliberate construction of it so that on, you know, on the 21st, the light shines in. 5,000 years ago, or 4,500 years ago, whatever, were people doing what people did this morning? Is it kind of, perhaps, could it be to those people who built it, this is almost as if some sort of communication from the other side was when the sun shone out?
Oh, well, yeah, partly, certainly. I mean, you have to remember that, you know, scientifically now we're so advanced, we understand where we are in the solar system and in this galaxy, and we're actually quite lonely out here. In those times, they didn't understand that. You watch as the days shorten and the amount of light contracts day by day. And if you're living, and remember, the people who built Newgrange were an agrarian community. They had just started introducing farming practices into Ireland. This is what allowed them to build monuments, because previously they had to hunt and gather their food. Yeah. They had more time for these sort of pursuits. But you could imagine, as the days contracted and the days shortened, you might wonder, was the sun going to keep going until it disappeared? Yeah. And you were going to be plunged into eternal darkness. This is a great day because, and it's a day of great hope, and that's why there's always such a buzz at Newgrange. There was a great buzz at Newgrange this morning, despite the fact it was cloudy in the valley. One of the reasons for that is because the days will not get any shorter than this. This is the shortest day today. Mm. Now, you won't notice it for a while. Probably the 1st of February, the first week of February is when you really notice, as the Irish say, a stretch in the evenings, you know. But this is the shortest day. It doesn't get any shorter than this. Once you see the sun, I suppose the people who built Newgrange, once they saw the sun returning on its path up the horizon, they probably breathed a fairly massive sigh of relief.
Is it known how many people are actually interred in it?
There were only the bone fragments of 7 individuals found at Newgrange. Now, Newgrange was rediscovered in 1699 by the then landowner Charles Campbell, who was a Protestant settler after the Battle of the Boyne. And his labourers were robbing stone from Newgrange to build his mansion when they discovered the entrance. And since then, a lot of people have been coming and going into Newgrange, and it's considered that maybe a lot of the fragments that were in there were maybe taken away or whatever. So it's very difficult to say how many originally, but say, for instance, at Knowth, I think in Knowth's eastern chamber, there's anything up to maybe 100 or a couple of hundred individuals, fragments, again, just fragments of people. But what is clear is that Newgrange was not a common burial place like a large cemetery.
Yeah.
It may have been for select elders of the community, and, you know, we're not sure about that sort of stuff, but it wasn't a mass burial place, certainly not.
Yeah, I suppose that's the amazing thing about it. There's probably lots of things about Newgrange we'll never know.
Well, maybe someday we'll learn to travel back in time and have a chat with our ancestors. And
wouldn't that be interesting? Anthony, thanks very much
for coming in to us
today. The name of the book is Newgrange, Monument, Immortality. Anthony Murphy is the author. We'll take a break after that. Movies and Booze.